Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My very special co-host today is Imani Cruzen. Hi, Imani. How are you?
Good. How are you doing?
Very, very good. Your guest today is?
Today, my guest is Tim Dickie, the Chief Program Officer with RISE, which provides disability services in Minnesota and Western Wisconsin.
Well, I have a very special guest today, too, and that's Shenna Lemche from Can-Do Canines, and they provide guide dog services or aid dog services for people with disabilities and other types of disabilities. And I understand we have a golden retriever who is about 24 months roaming the studio today, and I'm excited about that. And any other thoughts before we get going, Imani, you want to tell the audience?
Well, I think your segment sounds really fun, and I'm looking forward to speaking with Tim more about his work.
Yeah, it's been a while since we had RISE on, and I'm really excited about Can-Do Canines, too. So all that and more coming up next on Disability Viewpoints. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Disability Viewpoints. I'm Mark Hughes. With me is Shenna Lemche from Can-Do Canines. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Mark. Hi.
Great to have you. Well, a long time ago, Can-Do Canines was on this very show.
Yeah.
But I'm glad to have you back. Tell us a little bit about the history. You're having a lot of changes going on for the good over there.
Definitely.
And then we're going to find out a little later on how people can apply to get one of these dogs.
Yeah, absolutely.
And by the way, Fern is with us today.
Yeah, we got Fern, the golden lab mix down here,
there
too.
There we go. So tell us a little about the history of Can-Do Canines, if you would.
Sure, yeah. So Can-Do Canines is in its 32nd year. We're a local nonprofit in New Hope, Minnesota. And we were founded by Al Peters. Originally, he started using shelter dogs to provide hearing alert dogs to the population here in Minnesota for those in need. And beautiful thing about Can-Do is that we've always provided our dogs free of charge, and that's something that 32 years later hasn't changed, but lots of other things have. We now provide dogs for hearing assist, diabetes assist, seizure assist, mobility assist, and autism assist.
Great. So what is the process for anybody that wants to get a dog like this? It takes a while, but what is the process?
Well, so generally you can come to one of our open graduations and kind of get to know a little bit about our process that way. We always encourage people to do that or come to a Tales to Tell tour at our facility. We offer those every month. And if you think that Can-Do Canines would be a good fit for you, qualified individuals with a disability can apply online anytime. Mm-hmm. And generally the process is application, we'll collect a lot of information, get to know you as you get to know us, do an interview in person at your home, and from there we will, if your application is approved and accepted, start looking for a dog for you, for your specific needs, get that dog tailored, and then you'll go through some team training.
And then what kind of dogs do you have as a selection?
Yeah, good question. So Fern here is a good example. She's a Labrador Golden Retriever mix, and we do a lot of that. It's a nice blend of two really popular breeds. We also breed Labrador Retrievers. We have some Golden Retrievers and some Poodles in our program.
If for some reason a dog doesn't work out, what is the process then?
It's a good question. So we always say our dogs never fail, but they might pick a different career. So it's like, you know, you want to be an art major instead of a math major, and that's okay with us, and we support that. And some dogs also might not make it due to medical reasons. So those dogs are adopted into pet homes, and they lead happy, purposeful lives that way.
Great. And so what is the procedure as far as applying?
So that'll be going onto our website, candocanines.org.
Again, tell us that again.
Yep, candocanines.org.
Okay.
Yep, and go there, and our application will be online. And usually it's about 4 months from application through the interview process just to reach the acceptance or not level. And then after that, it can take 6 months to a couple of years depending on what you're applying for.
Okay.
But right now we have a very short wait for hearing assist, mobility assist. So if you think it sounds like a good fit, now is a really good time to apply.
So what is the process of training the new owner and the dog? So like when the dog goes home with whoever they're assigned to, and maybe that's not the right word, does Can-Do Canines do a follow-up to see how the dog does?
Oh, yes. So once you are accepted, then we match you with the dog, and you do some first solo group training with other clients that are newly accepted and learn about this wonderful tool you're going to get. Then you start some individual training with your dog, with one of our client coordinators, and they show you how to use the dog. They teach you the dog's language and all the commands the dog knows, and then from there, you move the dog into the home, have some additional training in public, because it's a totally different beast to work with a dog in public,
right.
And as well as in the home. So it can take about 4 months of pretty rigorous training with your client service coordinator before we certify you as a team.
Is there an adjustment, like let's say that you went from your home to a public event, is there an adjustment for you and the dog when you're in public?
A little bit. So the dogs do get to be a dog when they're at home. They're obviously there to help if you need anything. Mm-hmm. But going into public, we have them wear their capes. And because they're raised in this cape, they understand it's like wearing your tie
right.
when you come here.
Boy,
it's
yeah.
business.
Yeah, yeah.
So the dogs know they're going to work out in public. So it's pretty different from taking a pet dog out. But there's a little bit of an adjustment to get to do that.
So you give the clients the dogs. Now, how is Can-Do Canine funded? And I understand you have a new executive director.
We do. Jeff Johnson is our new executive director. He just joined us late last year. So we are completely funded by donors. So we have wonderful people out there who will sponsor teams, who will allow us to do everything that we need to do free of charge to our clients.
Okay. Is there anything that you think that I've missed? Should we bring the superstar Fern on now to see what she can do?
Yeah, so Fern right now is being puppy raised, so she can show off some of the things she's learned in her wonderful puppy raiser home. Once her puppy raisers turn her into college, she'll go through a final training phase where she'll learn some more of her skills, but she can show you some of her tasks that she's learned with her person
okay,
now.
Let's see them now.
Okay. All right, so you see I'm going to use some food because this is her paycheck. Okay, good girl. Okay, can you heel? Good girl, good heel. Can you sit? Oh, what a good girl. Ready? Nudge. Yay, good girl. So that nudge could translate into a get help, so she can go nudge a person's leg to tell them her person needs help. Or it could be transferred to like a push plate, so she would nudge, yay, in order to activate a push plate. Good girl, so good, can you heel? Very good, and how about a shake? Yay, good girl, Fern, good job. So that's just a little bit of what she's working on.
It's amazing how they learn that when they're so young. This,
yep.
This dog is only 21 months old.
That's right, and she started training the first day that she was born
right.
to be a service dog. We have them in onesies right away. We do all sorts of extra sensory exercises with them when they're just little baby babies.
So where do you get the dogs?
We breed our own dogs. Okay. For the most part, we do have some donated dogs from local breeders, and we also exchange puppies with a breeding cooperative of other assistance dog organizations.
And then you know the first day whether they're gonna work out or not.
Well, we give them a little more time than that, but it's a long process of evaluating the dogs throughout that full 2 years while they're being raised before they come to our facility for final training.
Okay, and that's an outside person that does that?
Before they come into us?
Before they come.
Good girl. So we raise our dogs through a combination of volunteer puppy raiser homes. Mm-hmm. And prison programs, actually. So we have seven prison programs in Minnesota and Wisconsin that help us to raise and train the dogs.
So actually in prison?
Actually in prison, yep. They live with the inmates 24/7.
Wow.
They do get out for furloughs and vacations into other volunteer homes. But it's really a cooperative network of really amazing, dedicated volunteers.
So what does that do for the inmate? Does that relax them or?
Yeah, it's really a win-win-win because the dogs get the training, the inmates learn, and it helps to really shape their character.
Yeah, they stay in the cell and they...
Yep, they live in their living quarters with them, and usually it's two inmates to a dog, and they'll take care of the dog 24/7.
Wow. That's pretty interesting.
Yeah, it's really
so
cool.
So what other tricks can you do there, Fern?
Fernie, what else can you do? Can you show a park maybe? So we teach the dogs a lot of how to stay out of the way. So tucking themselves under a chair. Good. Very good. So our goal is kind of if you can leave a restaurant with a dog and the server goes, I didn't even know a dog was there. That's the goal.
So my next question is this. When you train a dog, it goes with their new owner.
Mm-hmm.
How long does it take for the dog to get used to its new owner to realize it? This person, male or female, feeds me, bathes me, puts me out when I need to go outside, mm-hmm. whatever. How long does it take for the dog to recognize that? I mean, and by that I mean once it has left your program.
Yep. So the bonding process, so they're fully melded as a team, usually takes about 6 months to a year.
And you do that at your place there?
We'll do some of that at Can Do in person, on site. And some of it will take place in the client home. So mm-hmm. usually after certification, which is that 4 month first window, the dogs will have additional couple months where they'll really be working out some of the kinks with the human. And then at around 6 months, you really see them start to jive. And by a year, you would never know they weren't together forever.
And you would hope that once they're trained, they go on to the new family, if I can use that.
Yep.
That they are used to going to home.
Yes, they do it without missing a stride, really. Like, they transition a lot, so they're used to it. And we haven't really seen a dog that's rejected the idea of moving into a client. So
any final thought, anything that I might have missed?
I think we hit it all. But I do want to just say again that we are really on a short wait list now for especially our mobility applications. So if people are interested, contact us for more info.
So I do, speaking of that, when how was Canines affected during COVID? And did you place more dogs during COVID? How did that process work?
Well, interestingly, we were able to keep our operations going. We had a very, very lean staff on site working with the dogs and continued our client placement. So we ended up placing the same amount of teams that we had anticipated. So I'm pretty proud of our crew. We did a good job.
So if you were to recommend, if somebody's watching us at home and you were to recommend, boy, I got these dogs from Gando Canine, what type of person would you recommend get that kind of dog, and what does it really take?
I mean, it takes a lot of commitment. You have to understand that a dog is a wonderful tool in addition to your care team, but it's still a dog. So they're going to have needs of their own, and it's something that you have to have the mental, emotional, mm-hmm. financial ability to still support the dog.
Right, right. And how did you start Can Do Canine?
Well, dog training was my passion for my life, and I had an opportunity to turn my passion into a career, so left the corporate world, and here I am now.
So, can I ask what you did in the corporate world?
I was in human resources.
Well, this is a good choice right here.
Yes, the animals are good therapy after.
So, do you have one at home?
I have three dogs.
What kind are they?
They're border collies.
Oh, yeah, okay, good for you.
But they like the Labradors, too. We take a lot of fosters.
Yeah, well, great. So if the family where the dog is assigned to has kids,
mm-hmm.
What would you recommend, what would you not recommend? You know, are some too young and they'll be riding or pulling its tail or pulling its ears? What would you recommend and what would you not recommend?
So it's just like anything. If you teach the children correctly how to interact with the dog, we don't usually have to worry about them riding the dogs. But, a lot of our foster homes have children.
Yeah.
So we can always find a dog that's used to a little bit of extra kid cuddling
Great. Well, just by coming in the studio today, you know I like dogs. And this is, believe it or not, a real passion of mine for the disabled. And so I would like to hear back from Can Do Canines when you think it would be appropriate, when you have something new to tell us
Absolutely.
To come back on this show.
Absolutely. We would
love to. You guys are pretty near and dear to my heart. So
thank you.
I appreciate you being here. Again, Shenna Lemche from Can-Do Canines. Well, thanks for being with us, and we'll see you again real soon, okay?
Thanks, Mark.
Thanks for being on the show, and we'll be right back.
Today, my guest is Tim Dickie, the Chief Program Officer with RISE, an organization which provides disability services throughout Minnesota and Western Wisconsin. I want to thank you today for coming on, and I'm looking forward to learning more about your organization. So,
yes, thanks, Imani. Appreciate the opportunity.
Definitely. To get started, for those unfamiliar with RISE, could you tell me a little bit about some of your programming that you offer to the community?
Sure. Our programs at RISE fall into one of three service categories. There's employment, life enrichment, and housing. And I'll briefly cover each of these three, starting with employment, which is our largest service category. So employment services can really take on a variety of forms in a variety of settings, depending on the interests and support needs of persons served. For some, it can involve training to develop work skills in one of our own facilities where we contract with businesses to bring in paid work. We call this pre-vocational services. For some people, pre-vocational services can serve as sort of a stepping stone to community-based employment. So that's pre-vocational services. Then we have what we call group community employment. And group community employment involves teams of 2 to 6 people, typically, who work together in a community business, and typically with ongoing support of a RISE direct support professional. So in this setting, businesses contract with RISE to do the job, and RISE provides the coaching, the supervision, and the support to the crew working on that job. And so for some people, this is a long-term choice. And for others, it can serve as a shorter term opportunity to gain work experience, or maybe as a means of exploring what they like and what they don't like for work. Most of our employment services are focused on helping people find and maintain competitive employment. So competitive employment, by definition, is work performed in an integrated setting at wages that are customary for the position. So in other words, these are everyday jobs with wages at the going rate in the open labor market. And so how we deliver these services and supports is highly individualized. For some people, the supports can be very hands-on. We might be helping them with job applications. We might be reaching out to employers on their behalf and providing training and job coaching and follow-up supports for really as long as a person needs it. And then for other people, the supports can be more behind the scenes, and employers might not even be aware of RISE's involvement. One thing that we're really proud of at RISE is that over the last 3 years, we've helped over 1,800 people secure that type of employment, competitive employment. And so that's employment. The next largest service category is what we call life enrichment. So this is a program that's geared towards individuals with intellectual disabilities and brain injury. And the service focus includes things like health and wellness, community access, community safety, volunteer work, recreation, fitness, and leisure activities. Some specific examples of that might include things like music therapy, dance class, art therapy, and really just a wide variety of community exploration activities. Some of our life enrichment programs are embedded in community centers and YMCAs, which is a really unique and we think great model for some people. Then the third service category is housing. And so housing includes independent living supports and housing supports for people with mental illness. Some of the people that we're serving in this program have other barriers as well, such as poor rental history, criminal backgrounds, or chemical health issues too. Services in this program can be very short-term to very long-term. It really depends on the person's needs, and it can include supports like household management. So things like budgeting, shopping, healthy lifestyle skills. It could include cooking and nutrition. And it typically includes some form of financial assistance, like a rental subsidy, for example. So broadly speaking, those are kind of the three primary service categories at RISE.
And how have some of those programs or resources changed during the pandemic?
Like many businesses, the pandemic has forced RISE and other providers to explore new ways of delivering services and supporting people. One of the new and creative service options that was developed early on during the pandemic involved the use of technology such as video chat to provide remote or virtual services. We started by helping people get set up and trained with the platforms that we were using, which were primarily Microsoft Teams and Zoom. And we also provided devices such as tablets for those people that didn't have access to that technology. And initially, the services were designed to be kind of a stopgap until people could return to in-person services. So our focus then was on things like helping facilitate social connections, reducing the effects of isolation that were caused by the pandemic, understanding the current news and media communications, and just general kind of coping skills. This quickly expanded to other areas, and now our remote or virtual services offers really a wide variety of activities that were previously done in person. So the art therapy, music therapy, vocational skills training, healthy living classes, exercise classes, and virtual tours are things that are being offered right now. And I have to say that the feedback that we've received from persons served and their team members and families regarding remote services has been overwhelmingly positive. It's clear to us that some people are going to want to continue to participate in our services virtually or in combination with in-person services. And while it might not be for everyone, we do intend to maintain it as an option for those who choose it. At this point in time, we're serving over 120 people through remote services. The other thing that I just wanted to mention too is that the pandemic's really required us to shift in our thinking and how we support people who were in competitive jobs as well. Over 300 of the people that we supported who were working competitively lost their jobs because of COVID. And so the services and supports for those people needed to shift to things like navigating unemployment benefits, staying in contact with employers about possible return dates. For some, it was beginning a new job search. And for pretty much everyone, it also included providing emotional support. I will say that on a positive note, that the job market has rebounded significantly since that time. And many of the people who lost their jobs initially have either returned to those jobs or they've found new ones.
And you can find additional information about RISE's remote services on your website, correct?
Yes, that is correct. You can go to our website. Oftentimes, people are connected through RISE through like a county or state referral source. So a county social worker or case manager or voc rehab counselor. But sometimes we receive inquiries directly from people and their families, and we We help them navigate the social service systems in order to receive services at RISE or elsewhere. So yes, going to our website, you can find all the information under the locations tab of our website, and inquiries can always be sent to info@rise.org.
Okay, and could you share just the general website page for RISE and any other contact info people might need?
Yes, absolutely. It's www.rise.org.
Okay, thank you.
And within the website, you can find all the contact info under, there's a locations tab, and that's where you would find that.
Okay. And what kinds of outcomes does the organization work toward for those who are using its services?
Yeah, outcomes are very individualized, but there are a number of common outcomes that we track across or within each of the service lines. So examples of those outcomes might be things like the number of people that are, and percentage of people that are making progress on their goals, the number of people who are securing employment, what the average wages are, what the average hours worked are, how long are people staying on their jobs. And another really important one for us is the number of people who move from a center-based or contracted employment situation to competitive employment. And then most importantly, feedback from persons served and other stakeholders is a real important measure for us.
And is there anything else you would like to add about RISE?
Absolutely. Just a couple of things, Imani. We know that you've been keeping your viewers informed about the staffing crisis and disability services. RISE is not immune from those staffing challenges. So if you or your viewers know of anyone looking for a great place to work, working with great people, they should check out our job postings. And you can go to our website at rise.org/jobs is where you could see all of our current listings. And secondly, I just wanted to say it was a pleasure to meet you. We really appreciate the opportunity that you've provided for us to share some information on our programs. We also appreciate the good work that you are all doing there, keeping the community of people with disabilities and their support teams informed on important issues. So thank you.
Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to come on and help us learn a little bit more about RISE. So thank you so much.
We want to thank the studio audience at home for watching. We hope you'll watch again. On behalf of our entire team, Imani Cruzen, and everybody here at Disability Viewpoints, thanks for watching. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.